I'm Jim Whitehead. I'm the moderator of this distinguished panel. And I'm the CEO of the American College of Sports Medicine. I also serve a number of different roles, as everyone does. I'm chairman of the board of the Joint Commission on Sports Medicine and Science, and I'm a member of the Project Play Advisory Group. And as we go across the panel here, next to me is Dr. Robert Cantu, who's clinical professor of neurology at Boston University School of Medicine, the co-founder of the Sports Legacy Institute, and senior advisor to the NFL Head and Neck and Spine Committee. Next to Bob is Jayne Greenberg, who's the district director of the physical education and health literacy of the Miami-Dade County Public Schools. She's a member of the President's Council on Physical Fitness, Sports, and Nutrition, and a contributor to I Can Do It, You Can Do It. Next is Nancy Hogshead-Makar, who's founder and CEO of Champion Women, and hands would go up about this. She also happens to be three-time Olympic gold medalist in swimming and co-editor of Equal Play, Title IX, and Social Change. And our last panelist is Stephen Levin, who is council member of New York City Council and chair of the Committee on General Welfare. And he recently introduced a bill that would require doctors to be at all youth football games. So I think we know kind of the pattern of what this is. We're going to have the panelists address real quickly a couple of questions, and then we're going to start segueing to the audience. And I am wanting us to make sure that we take advantage. I told Tom Ferry this is going to be the best panel of any at this meeting with the best audience. So we got a lot to live up to here, but I'm highly confident that we will. But I do want to make sure that we have time to have Jim, our graphic reporter here, capture this, because these people, and Jim in particular, are very good at kind of getting the themes of what we're doing. Imagine trying to draw or illustrate what we're saying. Can you imagine that? But it does a great job with it, and I want to make sure that we take advantage of what he is doing by capturing everything here. And then the time will be up before we know it. We will try to stop on time, but I want to thank you all for being with us on this incredibly important issue and part of Project Play, which is to make youth sports even safer, to make it an even more enjoyable experience, and to make it even more inclusive. Very powerful kind of things that impact communities in the nation overall. So here we go. Here is the first question for the panelists. And again, I'm just going to ask two. And we'll just go down, unless you want to raise hands. No. We'll go down in line here, if that's okay. Why do you think this strategy, this priority of prevention, is essential to getting and keeping kids active through sports? Bob, start with you, please.
Jim, as a practicing neurosurgeon for over 50 years and having taken care of head injuries for over 50 years, I know there's no head trauma that's good for any brain. You cannot condition the brain to take trauma. You can strengthen the neck and reduce how quickly the head moves from a hit, directly or indirectly, but you can't eliminate it. So I think the prevention strategies that need to be considered involve those strategies of how can we minimize head trauma. And I'm going to focus on head because that's my area, and others can talk about ACLs, et cetera. Beside conditioning the neck, the way that we can best minimize chances for head trauma is to reduce it. That means starting later in life, playing those activities at high risk of head trauma in a manner in which the head trauma can be sustained. It doesn't mean you can't play them. We want kids playing every sport, but we want them to minimize their head trauma. So that means taking the tackle out of football under the age of 14. It means soccer, not having heading until the age of 14. When those ideas were brought forward a few years ago in our book, Concussion in Our Kids, which we did with Mark Hyman, who's in the audience, not too many people were tumbling to it, but now it's getting further and further thought. And with adding Brandi Chastain and also Cindy Parlow-Cohn, former Olympians, to the Safer Soccer campaign, which is initiated through Sports Legacy and Chris Nowinski. I think we're really gaining traction in soccer as well. So playing sports in a way that is less injurious to the head is very, very important. And then finally, we need to encourage kids to continue to play, but we need to very much, if we want to keep kids playing sports, not only do they have to be fun, but they can't be injured, because injury takes kids out of sports, and when kids have injuries, they often don't get back into sports. So I think all those things are very important for injury prevention in general, but especially as it pertains to concussion, which is a major thesis.
Excellent. Thank you, Bob. Jayne, same question?
Thanks, Jim. I'm going to take the approach of prevention through education, that I cringe when I hear people say the decay of physical education in the schools. I'm from Miami-Dade County Public Schools. We are the fourth largest school district in the United States, the largest accredited. We have daily physical education in our schools taught by certified physical education teachers. And we believe that when we have sampling of sports, when kids learn how to play, they gain the ability, we can condition kids, we can warm up, we prevent burnout because we offer a wide range of activities, that we see physical education and the education part of learning sport as the pipeline to participation. So through what we saw earlier, why kids eliminate themselves or why there is a decline in sport participation, we see through physical education and the teaching of sports, we give them the ability, the confidence, as you saw early, and then the desire to pursue through sport participation. But we see physical education as key and the training ground for injury prevention.
Great. Excellent, Jayne. And we continue now with the same question, just to remind us of why do you think this strategy of emphasizing prevention is essential to getting and keeping kids active through sports? Nancy?
Yeah, I think prevention, first of all, usually people want to talk to me about civil rights in sports, so I'm happy to sort of pull back from my sports experience, but I think prevention is the key that brings in so many of these other factors that we've been talking about. So prevention takes good coaching as an example. I'll give you just a quick example. It's really hard for me to watch on television somebody else do swim because I'm like, no, it's not supposed to be like that. So in a good stroke, it's okay, this is what it looks like when you have 10,000 hours of doing it. So with every stroke, notice that my shoulders, I'm a 90-degree angle to the bottom of the floor, right? Okay, and then here, whoop, same thing. So you're, as opposed to if you're flat right here, this is what you're doing, okay? Which one is gonna give you a shoulder injury really quickly, right? That's a lot of work on the shoulders. This is really not that much work on the shoulders. People don't get injured when they have good technique. So prevention is part of that early skill building on how it is that somebody does the sport in a way that makes it fun for them. They get that physical competence, that physical literacy that we've been talking about before. And those, the things that they learn in those early years are things that take them for the lifetime. My second point is that there are, when I was growing up, there was a, on our weight room, it said, no pain, no gain. Okay? And as Dr. Cantu just said, you can't condition a brain to accept concussion. It's the same thing with most overuse injuries. There's no distinction between the kind of pain where like every cell is like begging for oxygen. There truly is no limit to that kind of pain. I mean, you might pass out and it's very dramatic and somebody will pull you out of the water and right, and you know, your coach kind of puts you in, way to go, you know. but it's not as opposed to like when the shoulder goes click. It doesn't hurt, it's not a big deal. And so making that distinction between those kinds of things, because later on, not under 12, but later on, the point of being particularly an elite Olympic athlete is knowing where the line is on when to push it and when to pull back, right? It's everybody's pushing that line of you want to go right up to it, but you don't want to get sick or injured. So this issue of prevention, starting at under 12, gets at all of the other issues that we've been talking about.
Excellent. Stephen?
Thank you. So I think in looking at the issue, and I'm looking at it from a legislator's perspective, not so much as a coach or athlete. I think that having an effective prevention strategy, an evolving preventive strategy, making sure that we're keeping up with all of the latest research, it's essential to keeping our youth sports viable. As I've been looking at football and other contact sports, there's been a lot of good research out there. There's been also a lot of public discussion and public dialogue and public discourse on these issues. And I think in order to keep these sports, which have great value for our kids, as throughout their lifetime, so they learn wonderful, important lessons, physical lessons, but also teamwork and discipline. Keeping those sports viable on into the 21st century, as parents are very well informed, get more well informed, making sure that they're still that they're comfortable, that parents are comfortable knowing that their kids are going to be safe, and that great value is going to stay there. When we had a hearing a couple of weeks ago on this bill that we're introducing, and it's a somewhat controversial bill because there's going to be costs associated with it, and we're talking about having medical professionals on the sidelines of all games and full contact practices and football in New York City, the very first thing that everybody that testified, whether it was a coach, doctor, athletic trainer, the very first thing they said was, we need to make sure that we emphasize that youth sports, that football, is important, that we want to keep it viable, that we want kids to continue to play in New York City. We just have to make it safe.
Great, excellent, thank you. What we're going to do is we're going to have a lightning round of asking the panel, okay, given that, then what are the opportunities for action by any of these stakeholders, but by anyone? So we're identifying, okay, what do we do? What is something specific? These are activation sessions, and so I would appreciate you thinking about that also, if you haven't already, in regard to this emphasizing prevention area. We're not wanting to, I think everyone will be able to stay around for a little bit after the immediate end of this panel. So we'd have an opportunity for kind of the questions and answers without using up our time here. So when it comes back to you, it's not really about, I mean, if there's just something burning, you just got to ask, okay. But it's not really about questions and answers, because, again, you'll have an opportunity after. It's about what are the ideas, what are the actions that are going to make the most difference. And it could be something that you've heard here. It could be something in the Project Play report, or it could be something that you have brought into this meeting that you think would be very powerful to be considered, or it could be something that you've just pivoted off of from what you have heard. So anyway, that's a heads up if we could all be thinking about that, but we'll go really quickly in regard to what are the best opportunities for action on this by these stakeholders or others. Bob?
Yeah, I think the best opportunity for action, and the NFL has done this to their credit. There's a lot they can't take credit for, but to this they can. They've identified the activities at highest risk with regard to concussions. That's the kickoff. So what did they do? They moved up the kickoff line to 35-yard line, 50% reduction in runbacks. Over that's translated into 25% fewer concussions in the last year, 36% fewer concussions over the last 3 years. So identify activities at greatest risk. Two, change techniques to make the activity safer. In football, it's taking the head out of the tackle. That's all good. It's only part of the answer, but it's a very good start, and it's an important part of it. And the other thing is identify where most of the trauma is coming from. Well, most of the trauma to the head in virtually all sports is in practice, because you practice so many more hours than you play. Well, what is the activity in practice at highest risk? Well, in soccer, it's heading. In football, it's tackling. Take those practice. Keep track of how many hits you're getting to the head. Use the hit count analogy that Sports Legacy is pushing. I think it's a great one. Track hits. So you find your outliers, you pull back in terms of the amount of practice they have, and limit the practice. In the NFL, they can only hit 14 times in 18 weeks of the season. That's less than once a week. That's way below any other level. So these are just some very quick things that I think all the stakeholders can do, and I'm happy to field any questions on it.
Great, excellent. Jayne, please.
I'd like to continue with the importance of partnerships and how we make programs grow and opportunities available, because this is such a diverse group at Project Play. I'd like to use the example of Gen Youth Foundation and how they brought flag football into our schools in partnership with the NFL and USA Football and Fuel Up to Play 60. In October, we were given equipment for flag football. Gen Youth saw that our teachers, physical education teachers, were trained. We did the training at the Miami Dolphins facility, so we brought the NFL into it. And through physical education, we exposed 77,000 middle school students to flag football through 50 middle schools and 44 K-8 centers. As a result of teaching the teachers how to teach, they were able to teach the kids how to play. We also wanted to expand the number of girls, in particular minority girls, that participate in sport. So through the education component in physical education, we received the equipment, and now we have 30 comprehensive middle schools that offer girls varsity flag football. That's 600 more girls were added to the pool of athletes in Miami-Dade County through our middle school athletic program. So the power of partnerships, bringing together, enabling physical education programs, all sports. We've introduced netball to our schools. We have a large Caribbean population, so we wanted students that played sports in other countries to feel enabled to be the leader in the sports. So we've done this by partnering with organizations and outside agencies to enhance what we do in physical education. And through that, we prevent injuries because the kids are being trained properly.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah. I would have sports organizations adopt a expectation of no injuries, zero injuries. So I taught sports law where we talked about the Amateur Sports Act and high school, college sports for 12 years, and routinely I would ask the students, how many of you all have a lifelong injury as a result of your high school sports experience? And it was almost always 50%. 50% of those students had a lifelong injury. I was a world-class athlete for 8 years. After the age of 16, I never got an injury. It's not because I have a unique body. It is because I learned like where, when to push it and when to pull back, and have a relationship with my coach that I could say no. I knew what, you know, like his job is to push as hard as possible and to know when to pull back. But the expectation is zero injuries. There are two kinds of injuries. One is this overuse injury, which swimmers tend to get. Then there's that kind of injury that you can't help, like when swimmers hit hands when they're, you know, swimming hard and somebody breaks their hand. Those you can't really avoid. Or the kind of injury like that a Carl Lewis is going to have. He's going to pull a hamstring. It's going to be like that. It's just in a heartbeat. And so those kinds of injuries are harder to prevent, but still to have the expectation. Right now, my students, the general population, thinks that 50% lifelong high school sports injury rate is acceptable. So the expectation is what do we need to teach coaches? What do we need to teach students? How do you learn about physical literacy so that there are no injuries?
Excellent. Steve.
I think in thinking about this issue, hearing what Jayne said, following up on the idea of partnerships, as we've explored what to do in New York City and how to best use these incredible resources that we have. So, you know, across the board, I mean, whether it's hospital, other medical professionals, education, you know, the schools as, you know, that are training athletic trainers or physicians, we have all of these resources available to fully integrate into our kids' safety and youth sports in a way that we haven't been doing. So at a place like New York, you know, we have a public hospital system, Health and Hospitals Corporation, that has thousands of doctors affiliated with it. How do we best make sure that they're a partner in our high school sports programs? How do we make sure that the schools that are training our athletic trainers that there's a partnership there, that we know that there's that resource? I think the other thing that is interesting to look at now, and we've heard a lot about through this process, is the opportunity for education through technology. So, you know, we all have smartphones now, and you know, we have all types of apps for entertainment purposes and information purposes, but we can really use the type of information that can be conveyed through apps, smartphones, to best inform parents and coaches and students and keep track of injuries and make sure that we're using that technology to best inform how we move forward.
Excellent, excellent. Well, we have, I think, met part of our bargain of best panel. And now, but I also said we'd have the best audience, so it's your turn in regard to, again, I'm trying to make it not so much Q&A, because we're trying to get to activation. So if there's anything that you want to pivot off of or anything that you have as a different idea, we have mics that are available here. Let's get started, please.
Hello. So this is all about ideas, right?
Yes. And could you identify?
My name is Ingrid Fowle. I'm from Birmingham, Alabama. I'm working with the Lakeshore Foundation right now, but I've been making a lot of medical videos about gout, strokes, epilepsy for the past 2 years. And so I'm particularly interested in, you know, head injuries. I do want to make a national movie about head injuries that involves football players eventually. But the main thing I want to say is that there's a necessity to start teaching anatomy, even to five-year-olds, even if it's mild anatomy. Ask them, what's the most important thing about your body? Like, too often, little kids, even elementary school, middle school, high school, they don't understand their body. Having, like, a session where you stretch your foot or your leg or your arm and understanding what that muscle is called. Don't give them the simple name of it. Start teaching them the actual medical name first, because, you know, we actually learn faster when we're little. Like, it's so harder for me to memorize new muscle names like now. So I just wonder if that can be an essential part of our education, because now we have AP biology, AP chemistry. It's not an essential thing for people to learn anatomy in high school. We don't learn about that type of stuff anymore. So I don't know if it's different from state to state, school system and everything. And also, having seen a lot of neurologists in different hospitals along that line, I don't know, each doctor is very different. Oftentimes, I've encountered people with epilepsy that they don't really realize why they have epilepsy. So I feel like it's essential to make sure when you're seeing a patient to explain why they have that particular injury. So there's the whole education system within the school system and in the hospital room. So
thank you very much. With a mic coming over here, please. If you are wanting to talk, yeah, let's get the hands up. Go here, please, and try to keep it as
thanks,
concise
Jim,
as
yeah, I'll be really quick. I'm Laurie Wetzel. I'm Director of Policy Research for the American Heart Association, and I just wanted to try to expand the conversation a little bit, this great conversation we're having today, where the focus has been a lot on injury prevention, but also start to think about continuing to open this dialogue between public health and the opportunity for sport to prevent non-communicable diseases. And, you know, I think that's a really critical role in partnership with physical education and physical education providing that foundation. But want to kind of expand the dialogue if we can.
Okay, excellent. And I will come back to the panel for any kind of quick reaction in just a minute after we hear a bit more from the audience.
Hi, I'm Don Patterson from Art of Coaching Volleyball. I'm curious about this topic with prevention because there's so much specialization in sports these days. And Nancy, you talked about zero injuries. I'm just curious what the panel thinks about in this age of specialization in sports, and I don't see that changing anytime soon, for all those kids who are being encouraged to play the same sport and get better at it through high school, what are some of the thoughts on how you can prevent overuse injuries in that climate?
Why don't we throw it to the panel just real quickly on this for any of the three comments that we've had so far?
There's no question overuse injuries are greater if you're using the same part of the body all year long. And probably one of the big problems with not cross-training, not doing different sports, not using resistive working out as part of your problem is you don't necessarily work both sides of the body symmetrically, and that also is going to eventually catch up with you. So there's a lot to be said for not playing one sport year-round, and if you do, definitely have a resistive exercise program using both sides of the body.
You know, I'd also like to touch on that the early specialization, we're talking right now about young children, and they have to have an opportunity not only to participate in a multitude of activities and sports, but the parents and the coaches have to understand that if they're injured, they have to have appropriate time to heal, that they can't go right back into the sport too soon. And thanks for bringing that up. Overuse injuries is critical.
Yeah, the panel that was up here before us talked about how bad early specialization was and how the Olympic Committee has actually done really good research on, for Olympic gold medalists, when did they specialize in their sport? And except for gymnastics, most of them are over 12 is when they started specializing in their sport. As a swimmer, we did what only swimmers would ever do this. We called it dry land exercises. But it was a number of different things, and it was all intended to make sure that we didn't, to make it interesting, but also to make sure that we didn't get injured. But I would say the number one I did get injured when I was 16. I had a coach who was a screamer, yeller, and, you know, go, go, go. So, you know, I knew my shoulder hurt, but I thought, no, no pain, no gain. And I didn't win nationals that year. And when I was up on the second place podium, which, like, dear God, nothing is worse. Of all the losers, you're the best. I knew that it was only me that could have stopped that. He was not on that podium. And so, I was 16. I still had 6 more years of my career to go. Never got injured after that. Did he keep yelling? Absolutely, he kept yelling. But we eventually sort of got this trust where, like, you know, and that's part of what makes a really good athlete is having this superior kinesthetic sense that you know where your body is in space. And that's part of, again, the things that we're trying to teach here is physical literacy. Physical literacy is something, look, you know, people have knee problems now at, you know, I'm 52. So people have knee problems now, right, because they never figured out, like, when to pull back. They're, right, or think of all the injury, like they, just it's knowing your body really, really well.
Excellent, excellent.
No, I don't
okay.
need to necessarily.
Great. Coming from the audience.
Will Metzger with a company called At Peak. Reacting to what the summit last time you met said, where's the technology solutions? And Councilmember Levin has said, we have created an app that shows, because we know the injury profile by age, gender, and sport. We know the strength conditioning exercises to do starting preseason for kids. So we have that in an app working with sports medicine professionals from Hospital for Special Surgery and other places. So we can get that out to the kids to show them. And you've got to involve parents and coaches too as part of that, because coaches can encourage kids to do it. Kids are also encouraged when you create a social space for them to encourage each other, so teamwork and team spirit. The last part is to create a reward structure behind it, too. So I think that's one of the models that is an injury to reduce injuries overall is to create a technology platform, which is what we've done, and would love your reaction to that. Does it make sense?
Just a comment that I think needs to be made, and that is that you can be a better athlete as a youth, obviously, if you train in that sport year-round and have best teaching and technique and everything else. That doesn't guarantee you anything when you're 21. And there are many, many athletes that have played sports only from high school on up. There are others that have played it only from college on up. And there are even people in the NFL right now that have never played that sport, football, in college. They have the elite ability to do it and can pick it up.
Right. Excellent. So we're fulfilling the point of breakthrough ideas. I think that there are some
come. Yeah, I wanted to jump on your point of can technology help teach what I was talking about, kinesthetic sense? Absolutely. That I have asthma, and when I used a peak flow meter, I only used it for about a year because after a year, I could tell you what my peak flow was going to be. I knew what that feeling was, and I knew how to adjust medication. And I knew what to do. Based on using that, right? So the more data that you have, the more it'll but you have to tie it back to, you know, how do I feel? And, yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you. Over here, please.
Yeah, my name's Kip. I'm with Play Rugby USA. And my idea is around just changing the game, not being afraid to change the game. And I think it's an obligation of the professional sports leagues and national governing bodies to create a climate, a culture that allows young people to play a different version of the game. A great example is the Tennis Association and the work they've done with bigger rackets, bigger balls, and setting an example of changing the game to make it safer, like the NFL did with moving the kickoff forward. So creating a culture and promoting a culture that it's okay to change the game and it's not blasphemy if you do it.
Yeah.
Quick comment.
Yeah, so one, it's really interesting that, I mean, and that's a really important part as we look at youth football, for example. When I've been asking people for kind of trying to establish some norms and what's the same across the board, just trying to figure out exactly how many full contact practices are happening over the course of a season. I can't get a uniform answer from youth sports on up through high school, and I think that there needs to be a lot more openness to that type of reduction, changing the game, open mind.
Right. Can I add one more thing? So Dr. Cantu was saying how that, you know, if you take an 8-year-old and you make them train year round, they really will be really, really good at it. Let me tell you, swimmers, you can put a swimmer in there and they can have them be doing 10,000 yards and they will break all kinds of records. And I guarantee it that they are going to quit. It's not even close. So when I was 10 years old, apparently my mother tells me that I didn't even know it at the time, I was close to breaking some pool record. And so she tells my coach, like, you know, go. And my coach said, smart guy, if I push her, she's going to quit. So I never broke the record. I never even knew about the record, but I was having fun. And so when I see these kids right now and I see them up and they're doing morning workouts at age 10, give me a break. That is not the way that we develop Olympians. This is not the way that you develop lifelong athletes. This is not how you develop joy in sport, and it's certainly not how you develop prevention of injuries.
Excellent. We're managing our time remarkably well. Going to call on Tom. Anyone else? Get your hand up so we have a cue. Tom, please.
Hi, Tom Cove, Sports and Fitness Industry Association. Just want to pick up on that last point exactly. I wish I had a better idea, but I can identify the challenge and the problem, which is we speak a lot about how it's terrible to overemphasize and overspecialize at 15 or 12 or 9, and because that's not the way to develop elite athletes. The challenge that we need to just acknowledge is when you do overspecialize, to your very point, Nancy, at 15 you might probably be the best athlete or the 12-year-old, and the social dynamic around that. It's not that we're all trying to be Olympic athletes. People want to be the best, and we've got to change our culture to say being really great at 12 or 13 or 14 isn't as great as it seems at the moment, both for the parents and at the kids. It's a lot harder, and we should spend more time on that challenge of changing that culture.
Great. Excellent.
One of the pitfalls of our society today, just an opinion that's not medical, is that parents have to drive kids everywhere, whereas 40 years ago we took our bikes and we went everywhere and parents didn't care we were gone all day Saturday shooting hoops because they were just glad we're out of the house. Now parents are invested, taking their kids everywhere, and part of that investment is they get too invested in what the kids are doing. And I couldn't agree more, and that's an issue.
Great. Please, and just I don't think we have a way to show a graphic in this section, or do we? Okay, excellent, good. Great, we'll get to that in just a moment after this comment, and then we'll come to yours.
Wendy LeBolt, I'm a company Fit to Finish and a book by the same name. And Fit to Finish means keeping athletes in the game their whole lives. Mm-hmm. And Dr. Cantu, I've followed much of what you've done. I work in the soccer realm, and I work with concussion injuries. And what I would say, it's interesting, I don't know so much about the policy, but I know we need it. And so when we establish policy that has a dividing line and says at 14, there we go, at 14 we're going to stop heading. I learned at the ACSM meeting, they said whenever you reintroduce heading, you're going to have a spike in injuries. And so it's not just that we have to have the policy. Coaches, parents will latch on to those numbers. But we need to have a policy and a spectrum that says, and I think Brandi Chastain says it as well, it doesn't mean we're going to just all of a sudden start teaching that, right? But we're going to have we're going to head with smaller balls, lighter balls. We're going to teach the jumping technique. We're going to teach the kids to protect themselves. And that's a coaching education issue, I think, that the policy leaders have to start. And I love the concept of let's start with zero tolerance for injuries. I don't think we've done that, and we need to. So thank you for saying that.
Great. Excellent. I did want to comment on the infographic that is in this section. I'll just kind of briefly. What it addresses is youth coaches, I mean, just to the point, who say they are trained in key areas from CPR to concussion management in between. And what the graphic depicts is very low percentage of coaches are really a concerning low percentage of coaches are trained in that. So we'll insert that as something that is out of the report and...
support.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And can I just, one thing really quickly I want to mention is when we had our hearing, this was something that was really shocking to me. We had a coach in a youth sports league. He'd been the director for 20 years. He said in his whole league, he's got numerous teams, his whole league, in 20 years, he's only had 4 or 5 concussions for a youth football league. Mm. And that was the most alarming thing that came out of that hearing, because it's so clear that he's just missed hundreds and hundreds of concussions. Mm-hmm. And so that education, I think, is so, so vital moving forward.
Excellent, excellent. Yes, please.
So, I'm Meredith Aronson with the President's Council. And one thing that we've talked about is specialization and how that can be detrimental for athletes. But we also talked about how kids want to specialize. And as Tom just said, they want to be the best. But how can we infuse other principles into the system, into the sport-specific areas that might help prevent injuries? For example, as a basketball player, ACLs are huge. So building up the muscles around that, how can we diversify those activities and give the coaches tools to do that? I think that will be helpful as well. And we also heard this morning asking kids what they want, as Tom gave his example of the roadkill team and having them come up with fun games that make sense, but they also might use different muscles that might help to minimize the specialization despite the fact that they might just want to play one sport at that time.
Great, excellent. Any other audience comments? And
I just want to add one issue that as a parent, I have a 14-year-old and twin 9-year-old, so I'm right in the middle of this, that I have a hard time with is finding coaches who gave me what I had, which is what my first coaches were phenomenal at giving me good fundamentals. Whereas I find it very hard to find coaches that provide good fundamentals that make it fun. My kids go, and the coach has a different agenda. So I have to pull them aside. Have you heard of this Project Play thing? I give them Tom's book all the time. But having again that kinesthetic sense, learning fundamentals, how a ball bounces, how to throw, how to squats so that you don't hurt your ACL, how to pivot shoulders. Those kinds of things, that is, as a parent, is the hardest thing for me to be able to get.
Oh. And having those early positive learning experiences where the kids do learn the basics. If you learn the basics, you get proper training, proper conditioning, that's the best way to prevent injuries. And we know active kids do better. Mm-hmm.
Great, excellent.
I was just going to add to that. Again, I think some of the best, Greg Myers, Inside Children's, and I think some of the best evidence on preventing all types of injuries at preparatory conditioning, and that's probably why some of the sports specialization athletes, they jump into their sport and then go, and there's no progression, where the multi-sport athletes have that progression of training prior to sport. So that hasn't been mentioned yet, but what we've seen in the data, that's what we're seeing.
Great, excellent. One other comment, and then we're going to go to Jim to confirm the brilliance of both the panel and the audience. Yes.
Hi, Nancy Tsai. I'm with the American Council on Exercise. I'm also a board-certified sports medicine physician. And I just want to make this kind of a fun thing. We need to put fun back in fundamentals. Mm-hmm. We need to put fun back in function. Mm-hmm. And what it comes down to is we would never tell our kids, you only get to eat bananas. Bananas are great, but you would never just eat bananas. You would want to eat a well-rounded meal. And we would never tell them, you only do writing or arithmetic. We want them to be well-rounded. It's the same principle with physical activity. Maybe if they're not into sports, I know this is a sports-centric sort of a group, but
How about music? How about playing drums? How about dance? Those are kind of still in the same realm of physical mobility and keeping it fun. Those are all those different types of things. And so I just want to challenge people to come on back, put the fun back into things, but make it diverse and make it fundamental and functional.
Excellent. Any comments from the... Before I turn to Jim, because I wanted to make sure we did get some feedback from this, because I think we'll find it very, very fascinating. The report itself, under emphasizing prevention, does a lot of different things that, you know, really being careful about collision sports at a certain age, presenting other sports alternatives, not that somebody's going to drop out, and even a tracking tool across sports that would... keep track of both injuries and physical activity levels provided by the sport. So lots of good ideas as we had coming into this meeting. But let's turn to Jim and see kind of his feedback. And he told me before, you know, I'm doing this real time, so, you know, if I miss something or misinterpret something, you know, just kind of let everybody understand that. So I think this is a remarkable art and science of what he does. But Jim, please kind of give us a feedback on things.
I want to hear more from you. Thank you very much. Like all the other sessions, this has been great, and I know there's probably a ton of ideas that's still out there that are just waiting to percolate up. I was surprised we even had to state the problem, why it's essential, that, you know, talking about the prevalence of the injuries and the lifelong injuries for kids up through high school. You know, and balancing that with the idea that sports are important. I mean, we can't just do away with sports and, you know, ban everything. We just have to figure out a way to encourage to do it safely. I love this whole idea around early education, even starting with young kids and getting them to just be aware of their bodies and how they function and then building on that. A lot of talk about that progression of training, which I think ties in nicely with the last session we were talking about the variety, the diversity of different sports, sport sampling, so that you're getting a well-rounded physical education. Certainly, tying back in, putting fun in, zero injuries. I think that ties in nicely with the keep playing, but it is possible to do this without getting injured, and make that awareness to the parents, the coaches, and the students. Use of technology, there's so many great apps out there that are available for people to use to not only track their progression, but keeping them aware of what some of the consequences, what some of the lifelong injuries could occur, which ties in nicely with the change of the culture. Great examples of changing the game. The NFL, if the NFL can change, why can't everybody, you know, school sports change? Likewise with tennis, again, bringing in the coaches as part of this awareness and education and culture change. I'm sure there's more, but I think that's the highlights for now.
From what you've heard, that's a great job, Jim. I appreciate it very much. From what you have heard or picked up on in our discussion, was there something not highlighted or that you don't see here that you might want to? We're going to be using these depictions very very meaningfully in our planning. Yes, please.
Again, I'll tag upon what Jayne was saying. Again, I think there's one mechanism where we can reach all of our
kids, and that's through physical education. There's an infrastructure that reaches almost every kid. But what is government doing? What is our school program doing? We're taking away teachers and opportunities for kids. And these are the group of people that are trained to teach movement and plan for these. So I don't think that that's being, there's a lot of organizations here that are providing opportunities, but we'll never reach every kid unless we use physical education as our primary catalyst, and then other things kind of build off of it.
Great. Any last 30-second point that anybody would want to make or you'd regret forevermore in your life if you didn't before you left here? Anything else that we have burning, Risa? Oh,
There's one comment here, please. At the U.S. Lacrosse National Convention from Holly Silvers. Oh, from Holly Silvers, who's part of Santa Monica Group. She said, we have so much great medical information out there. We have studies that show we can reduce injuries overall by 50%, ACLs among girls by 70%. We've got to get it out of the medical journals and onto the field.
Excellent. If you would just stand up.
Hi, everyone. So all of you know, right, the whole theme around Project Play today is what's your play. And so we're really excited that at the end of each of these activation strategy sessions, we have some folks who have already let us know what their play is. I'm wondering if Erin Smith from U.S. Lacrosse happens to be here. She's downstairs. Are you from U.S. Lacrosse?
I am, but I don't remember. I don't know what she put in. We both put in separate.
All right. Well,
just so we're not missing something, because we certainly have hit on everything else, I can share with you Russ Pate, who some of you know. On Monday and Tuesday, we had a meeting of the National Physical Activity Plan of revising that. And Project Play is working its way toward being a central strategy for sports within the U.S. National Physical Activity Plan. We still have to go through steps in that. But that is a great leap forward, and I'm committed to making that happen. I'll just have to work with colleagues to make it so. So we got that? So good? Could we? There's nothing else you're going to? Okay, great. Why don't you stand up? Just I apologize for keeping you sedentary for 50 minutes, but I know you can do things. First of all, let's give a great standing ovation to this marvelous panel. Best panel ever.